Okay, today we kicked off the initiative Building Sense Now. Building Sense Now basically is our motivation to make a change in the built environment. We met, I think, 6 months ago and discussed why don't we see more sustainable buildings in the world? Why do our cities always look the same wherever you are? Why don't we have more sensible architecture to culture, to its climate context? And that's basically when we came up with the idea that we want to start an initiative, not another organization, but something where we make a difference, where we address architects and designers to fight to do the right thing, to disrupt basically the old concept of how design is being done and stop waiting for maybe something sometimes will change. In our built environment, because we're building today and we're renovating today the buildings we see in 2050. And we're still far, far away from having really sustainable buildings, cities which make us happy and healthy and have a positive impact for the people and for the environment. And that basically is what we started today, an initiative like a grassroots movement for architects, a global initiative. It's, for us, was very important to bring together the best minds, the right know-how to think about what can we do, where do we need to make the change, how can we get clients motivated to maybe go the extra mile to fight for what it's right, to use the right materials, to maybe look into low-tech solutions, passive design solutions, and not build everywhere in the world, it doesn't matter where, the same kind of architecture, and in the end, heal it with energy. So this is basically how we started.
Yes.
And
yeah, I was just going to say that, you know, what we felt was that buildings were kind of, you know, being designed all around, but a lot of kind of work was being done from the government side. You know, even the banking side is getting into this, but somehow the design community wasn't really getting engaged in some way and in a serious kind of way into this conversation. And I think it's really important because, you know, if you're doing a medical, you know, intervention, the doctor is key in this. And really the architect or the designer is the custodian of the building and its intellect of how it's done. So the question we were asking is, why is so many buildings looking all the same and why are they not built sensibly? And what would it take to kind of get, you know, building sense now, right? And I think the conversation was that, how can we make sure that the design teams across the world are having a key purpose in this and a key focus to kind of scale this up, right? And I think it's been a great session today. We had some of the top architects from India, from London, from Germany. It was a great debate looking at what are the challenges, right? We looked at, you know, some of the key kind of pushbacks that you get, including, architects have no control. The client decides there is, you know, very little incentive for the design teams to do anything. And finally, you know, architects are kind of, you know, slightly... sort of mistaken as to what works, essentially. So it was important to kind of look at what are the kind of challenges and see, you know, where do we want to go. What I loved about this was the kind of, you know, Michael's kind of question, where do we want to be in 2 years? And I think it made us all reflect as to the urgency of the problem, but, yeah, you know, also being practical as to the fact that we may be able to take two or three important things and really push for that rather than kind of try and take on too much more. Mm-hmm. And the fact that even though, you know, you can't really take the architectural community or the design community by itself, by focusing on it, you can really at least come up with a campaign and a way to communicate with them. Otherwise, you kind of spread too thin, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and it's not about blaming, you know. It's,
right.
And this is our motivation. It's more to get them engaged and to rethink, because I think this is what right. we feel. Sometimes it's just common sense to do the right thing and
yes.
to realize quality and to translate sustainability in
right.
in quality and asking the right questions and taking that time during a design process to really challenge as well the client, maybe with what we discussed today, with easy yes or no
yes.
questions, to really get a clear picture of what mm-hmm. is the aim of the building, what is the building supposed to do once it's completed,
right.
and to think about the life cycle of a building. We have to move away from what we, I think, still see too much today from very inexpensive as possible in the shortest amount possible, and then someone will come and will maintain the building somehow.
Right.
And this is where basically after completion the real work starts, and we have to put more thought into design and maybe build simpler and more sensible buildings which are able to adapt over time, which are able to be optimized to really have that performance we need. Because otherwise our CO2 emissions are going up.
Yes.
If we see what we discussed today, markets like India,
right.
where we will see such a huge growth in the built environment until 2050,
right.
we have to change today with what kind of materials we're working, what kind of technologies we're using. And I think we have to bring back the more cultural driven sense of what does really make sense, what does really make a good building in maybe the more southern climates, and because the air conditioning cannot be the solution globally.
No, absolutely. And you know, coming from India, I've seen the change in my lifetime, right? And and it has been in somewhat a good change as well. Urbanization has meant for a lot of us a better life and better education, better a lot of things, but really what it's also meant is that, you know, a lot more buildings are being built, and to the extent that, you know, the amount of construction impact from building materials is the same as the operations. It just shows you how much more there is to be built and operated, and if all of that has air conditioning, and which is rising at 20% per annum, we're almost going to have double the CO2 impact just from countries like India and China, where, you know, COP is happening this week. And you know, it's sort of, there has to be some importance and urgency to kind of tackle the impacts from buildings in developing countries, which are really rapidly growing and doubling in stock. You know, these places, they knew what to do, right? They had good vernacular architecture with a courtyard, high ceilings with ceiling fans. So they, you know, because we've had years of lack of power, so they had to improvise in a lot of ways. But today, you know, with increase in population, a lot more buildings, even that little bit of increase is going to have a big impact.
Yeah.
And if you think of the fact that it's very dense, very hot and humid and urban heat island effect and dusty and noisy, what tends to happen is the simplest solution. It's not just a cost issue, but, you know, just put glass, let's shut it all out, and let's have air conditioning, right? And that is where the problem starts. And then you land up having a whole effect where your air conditioning is leaking the heat out on the street, and then you need some more of it. The point is that where do designers play a role in this? And I think it's critical through design that we can find a new vernacular, a climatically appropriate, culturally appropriate kind of language, if you like, or pattern for our cities that really can find a way to kind of find the right balance. You know, it's not about not using air conditioning at all, but finding the right balance between, you know, when you need it, when you don't, having that right kind of, you know, mixed mode, if you like. And that's only possible through good design.
Yeah.
You know, good shading, good lighting, good glass, and probably managing the cooling properly.
Yeah.
And that's really, you know, was great to kind of get the comments from others and really get the focus on that, you know, as far as I saw. Yeah.
And I think the international context, you know, I think what, what we really need and what we want to achieve with that initiative is as well knowledge sharing. Because I think a lot of things we see as well in the developing countries is this hunger for being modern, for being up to date. And then they think maybe the things being done, how it's done in Europe or in the States, this is the way to go.
Right.
But it's not the way to go. You know, there are a lot of mistakes and a lot of buildings are still not really working properly.
Right.
And I think this is the big opportunity for this initiative to create a global network where people not only talk always about great designs and the great rendering and great ideas, but maybe share as well what didn't work.
Yes.
You know, because that's what we learn. We have to make new mistakes. And right now what we see in our built environment
is repeated mistakes.
Yeah, everyone tries it again and again, and they want to be always very special. And, and collaboration, I think, is a very foreign concept still.
And I really think that, you know, architects care deeply about the built environment. They live in it. They, you know, more than most professions, they get a lot of joy from design. And if you can get them to see this, but also to kind of participate and join forces, I think then that, and also realize that they're not alone. A lot of times, you know, designers feel like, okay, what is my building going to make a difference to the urban infrastructure? But if you can get a community behind this and really find practical solutions, I think that was an important kind of discussion. You know, what are we going to take forward and how are we going to consult?
Yeah.
But just simple things like, what is the incentives we can put in place? you know, for the architect? How can we communicate to the clients to talk to the architect to get the right messaging? Your performance-based contracting, idea of actually going back and visiting the site and seeing, making sure the performance was as designed. And there could be some rewards that could be arranged in the contracting part of it, which is very typical from a manufacturing perspective. But, you know, why not bring this into this field too, right?
Yeah, I think there's still some room for coming up with new and innovative ideas and different processes, and to maybe engage as well, you know, in the end, the user, the tenants of the building, and to motivate and educate as well the client for what kind of choices do they have. And I think this is what we see today too much, is this one-fits-all mentality all over the world, and it's easy and quick, and then someone else will take care of it. And this is really what we need to change, and what we hopefully will be, what we will change with that initiative. Yeah.
You know, just being an architect myself, working in a financial institution, I think it made me realize that, you know, I was blind to the fact that the architect's clients are deeply connected with the financial world, and they're really, you know, the pain that the client faces when it comes to the financing part. And also, it could be seen as an opportunity. If the architect could understand how buildings are financed and what, you know, what it means to save energy, and also to kind of understand what it means when the value increases of the property. Mm. You know, just to give you an example, from an equity perspective, you know, if the property is able to save 1% in running cost, the value of the property goes up 10%, right? So that is because, you know, especially on the rental mold, that means it's a better product. And if you can, if the architecture community or the design community can tap into that and really find that their buildings are valued more, that could be a great driver for the market as well. So it doesn't have to be just out of responsibility or guilt, but it could really be a business model for these designers.
Yeah, and they could just, you know, make their life easier as well if they look more into standardization. And we had a very important topic today, was the kind of building materials we're using.
Yes.
And I think this is another important part, what we want to emphasize in that initiative is that kind of knowledge sharing, because there are certain materials that are not allowed anymore in the EU. Why should we build with them in India?
Right.
And to ask the right questions, to come up with own standards and an understanding of what do I want? What kind of quality do I want? And this is not about investing more money. This is more about
choice.
Having the knowledge, the choice, and maybe putting in a little bit more work
thought,
and research and thought.
Right.
And then we will see a big change.
That's so true. You know, there's a lot of kind of confusion in a lot of the markets that there's something like a green material, which is something else.
Yeah.
But actually just good design, you know, just using less steel by bringing, you know, the beams a little bit more efficiently designed in the building. You know, you're a structural engineer. You can do so much more in optimizing the embodied energy of the building. And just getting that point across, you know, that really brings the design in the heart of this conversation, right? It's not, you know, a lot of times what's happened, I noticed that the green community has been a little bit, you know, the design community has not been that engaged in the green momentum. They've seen us as a certification play.
Yeah.
But if you can make it central to the design function, where, you know, the designer says, okay, you know, good design is design that can be more resilient. A good design is one that uses less materials, less toxicity. And basically, it is just a sensible building, you know. That's what green is, essentially.
Or the new normal, you know, like you said, you know, it's part of the industry. They use it basically as a marketing tool.
Right.
Not everyone, you know, but and I think what we have to do and to achieve is that people understand it's just normal. It's normal to have quality, because what's the price tag of quality? Mm-hmm. I always get asked, you know, what is the benefit of doing a sustainable building?
Right.
What is my financial incentive? Well, the question is always, what's the benchmark?
Yes.
You know, is it okay today that we see so many buildings without proof of quality, and people say, yeah, it's okay, or it's okay, I didn't do a sustainable building.
Right.
And I think we really urgently need to start that conversation in the designer and architect's world, and to bring them to their senses, and to build sensible buildings.
Yeah, and I think this will need disruptive innovation, not so much in terms of design, in the approach to how we bring this to the market. Because I think that, you know, the architectural community has work, the design community has work, the developers do their thing, and it's a moving market. But realizing that the carbon emissions from buildings will double in stock, you know, really means that it's not about just kind of, you know, kind of talking them into this. There has to be a good disruptive model that makes them just realize that you know, that highly glazed buildings in the middle of a desert is like having a fox fur, right? It needs to be that impactful, that it is actually what you're doing is very bad, and that needs to connect to some level. And we should also look at, you know, how can we reward good design? It's not just about not doing something. It needs to really think hard about, you know, is it thinking about financial incentives, but also just, you know, getting better work, higher premiums, all of that needs to be built into this.
Yeah, and how can we make it scalable? I think that was one of the topics everyone was concerned
today.
Because we won't save the world with lighthouses.
Right, right.
Leadership is not scalable. So what we need is the small steps. And we have not only to get the big firms on board, we have to get the small firms on board.
Yes.
The ones who say today, you know, it's so far away, we don't have the resources to join an association or another organization, and climate goals are kind of something out of their scope. But everyone can contribute, basically, can make the right step. And this is what we're going to do during that initiative, to give tools, to give ideas, to give motivation, so everyone moves in the same direction.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, where we landed was quite interesting. I mean, we said, okay, there are certain things that we absolutely know which is wrong, and we're going to communicate that to the outside world together. We also know that, you know, we have some ideas, but we need to test it with the market, do a focus group, do some surveys, and get more people into the conversation to recommend what are the right ways. And finally, kind of come up with campaigns where we know that absolutely needs to be something around this. And I think we should really be, you know, it's got a great team here, you know, in terms of the kind of people and the experience. From Michael, Peter, Ashok, and your team here, it's been great to kind of see, you know, what else are we missing? You know, who do we partner with?
Yeah.
And what is the key message we want to get across to have more people buy into this, right?
And very encouraging, because it was our idea out of a conversation.
I know.
That apparently we're not the only ones being concerned about that. That a lot of architects we talked to outside that group already said, well, this is exactly what we need. We need that space, and we have to address things because we cannot going on like this. And we need more transparency, and we have to maybe reinvent certain things, and we have to disrupt the way we've done things, and we have to get out of this vicious circle and this circle of blame to be a positive part of the whole industry.
Correct. We need to make it into a virtuous circle of, you know, whatever that is.